which then you get this information. You know how the homogeneity acts, so you know how RP acts depending on K, and you moreover have the shift by 1 minus K. So if you prefer, you have the sum, maybe lambda n over n to the S, is a product of what? Of 1 over 1 minus lambda p to the minus s plus, then I will make a mistake certainly, it must be p to the 1 minus, yes, 1 minus k minus 2s. With the lambda.
Ah, okay.
With the lambda. Now if you look at the series with the a, the 1 minus k transformed to k minus 1. Because of this stupid thing. So, well, it's not very important. So the p here gives you a power 1, and the homogeneity, the rp, gives you p to the minus k. Because of the homogeneity. So, if you look at the series of the lambda, you get that. But the classical people generally, Hecker, they didn't use the lambda n, they used the an. And the relation between the lambda n and the an, with that one, is there is a shape by n minus 1 minus k. So, that's life. But essentially the same. Well, in both cases, you have an Euler product, and that's the origin of a good part of the theorem. Okay. So now I can pass to the Adelic picture. What do I want? Okay. So I have to realize essentially everything. I'm sorry for being so slow, but maybe I should skip all that, but I'm not so sure. Okay, so the Pontryagin is a virtue. To me, it's really the basic thing. So, this is the reason why this subject is natural. And it is essentially because of that we shall see them. So again, another way to look at that is this. You look at Z2R over N Z, and you go to R over Z, 0, and you pass, and you pass to the projective limit. Then you get 0 goes to Z, I call it Z bar, not Z hat, because Z hat is for the dual. Z bar to A over Q goes to R over Z. And in fact, if you do that, you have similarly an exact sequence I like, GLN of Z bar goes to GLN of Q under GLN of A. And GLN Z under GLN R. So it's no more an exact sequence in the sense of groups, because these are homogeneous spaces, but it's a vibration. And which means what? It means that, in fact, if I was working with SL2, that's the only point where it's easier. If I write SL2R modulo gamma n, where gamma n is the matrices, gamma is the set of gamma in SL2Z, congruent to 1 modulo n. Now, if I take the projective limit of this guy, well, this is the same as SL2A modulo SL2. So in some sense, going to the idyllic picture is simply looking at all the coverings, you look at the classical object, and you look at all the coverings. And you take the projective limit for all the coverings. So, but for SL2, it's not convenient to work with the Hecker operators, as I said, because essentially Hecker operators don't belong to matrices of determinant 1. It's only the Tn square for n square that belong to SL. So, in fact, it's really because you look at all the possible covers that you are interested in, and you have to work with them. And to do that, the simplest thing is to work adelitically. Moreover, in that setting, the Hecker operator are completely natural. So maybe the main point. I was not careful in writing my notes on the translation. I am so used to that I forgot to note that in detail. So the point of all that is, if you look now for me, from now on, I will forget completely about the classical picture from now on. G will be a reductive group, reductive algebraic group, algebraic connective group over Q. Or another field. I will not discuss the case of function fields, also with some interest to Parchin, but I let him discuss the case of function fields. So we will discuss only number fields. So I will be interested in GA or GAF. So, the space I want to look at is the GAF minus the space I call AG. So I will define for you the AG in general. This is what I call AG in that system. It's the image. So in general,
the section is not really completely canonical.
It's not canonical. Except that there is a standard choice. So I will explain it. So let me see. So places. So if F is Q, this is just R.
S of A, or if you prefer, F infinity is F times R. So this makes sense. Now, in S of F tensor R, you have for F, more generally for in F tensor R, you have a way to embed R here. I mean, for places, this is a product of R to the R1 times the C to the R2. Now, R, you embed it diagonally in the various copies. You have an embedding. So, this is a natural embedding. It's not unique, of course, you could choose just one place, but the traditional way is to use a diagonal embedding. Now, with this choice, this defines the section. So, okay, I'm sorry, I was a bit confusing, but if you think of the case of GLL, you will see immediately how to do it. So the only non-canonical point is how to embed R in F tensor R. So once you have done that, you have a canonical choice.
Choice of what?
Of a section? Of a section?
I don't think in chi, right? We consider all of them together.
So somehow, you...
So I consider a base.
You have your G of A, F. You have a natural map to AG. AG is this object. Well, you take an X here, and you associate to it the map chi goes to absolute value of chi of X. So this is an element of AG. To X, you associate the function of an element which sends, oh sorry, to log it. Sorry. The tradition is to look at it as a vector space. I'm mixing the vector and the multiplicative group. So I could have said AG. Without the log, I would put a big A for passing to the vector. So now you have this map. And by factoring so Z, A, F, and that here, so you have here a map, and what I said is I can construct a canonical section using this prescription. Okay. This prescription is not exactly canonical, but that's the standard one. It's canonical with comma. I mean, but you always do that, and then it's perfectly factorial when you change the group and so on. So it has all the properties. If you are thinking of the function field case, this won't be exactly the same. Because of what? Here, you don't get something surjective on R. It will be only in a lattice. So you will get a lattice here, and you will get a lattice here. And the image is of finite index, but it's not an isomorphism. So that makes life slightly more complicated. Just, I don't know what the good picture is. I never tried to see what exactly the good choice would be.
Why is this decomposition is not canonical?
Hmm?
Why is not canonical this decomposition? It's canonical. Or it's...
So the choice of the split torus is not a problem because it's in the center. So there is only one. So this is canonical. You look at the real part. This is canonical. Now, what is not canonical is how to embed R into F tensor R. It's canonical if you admit that I take the diagonal embedding. I always do that. Then it's canon. Then it's well defined. But you might think of other choices, of course. But it's not natural. So that's the way it is done usually. Okay.
So since you said you like to discuss, so I have a question.
Of course, please.
Is it true that if you consider the kernel of the map from G of AF to the algebra to AG, is it true that this is a subgroup generated by all compact subgroups?
It's a subgroup which was
generated by all compact subgroups. It's true that any compact subgroup within the kernel.
Of course, compact subgroup is the kernel, yes. But no, it's bigger, I think.
And we consider single stations in previous lectures. So, for example, for GL and GLN, this would be the element, the matrix is such that the norm of the determinant is 1.
Yeah. Yes.
It seems that it's true that this, at least in the local non-recommending case.
I guess maybe in local, but I'm not sure in general. But okay, so in the literature sometimes, so there are two choices. Either you take GAF mod AG or whatever is in the center. So that's a nice object. Another choice is to take GAF 1, which is precisely the kernel of this map. So for example, Jim Arthur works with this.
Who?
Jim Arthur. You always work with this. But to use this, this is equivalent. But this is more natural in some respects because, for example, this group is not a product of local objects. So, while GAF is really a product. So, it's a minor difficulty, but it shows up from time to time. So, it's nothing very big, but this will show up from time to time. Okay. So now, let me explain what is the general picture for automorphic forms in the adelic setting. So I'm sorry. So what you look at, what the space you want to study, the X will be simply the G AF mod AF mod AG, sorry. And the gamma will be G of F, and the X over gamma is just this G mod G of F. And AG, you can put it on both sides, it doesn't matter since it is in the center. So this is really the space you are interested in. And the theorem of Harish-Chandra, again, well, in that case, I already studied it, is that the volume of X mod gamma is finite.
So it's equivalent to the previous.
It's absolutely equivalent. It's not equivalent. It's less strong because there are arithmetic groups that don't come from the adelic picture. So it's more restrictive.
Ah, but you're not commensurable with.
Yeah, there are funny objects I never considered. I know they may exist. That's all. Yeah. And they don't show up in the adelic picture. So it's a simpler case.
So now, what is the rest of the game? Now, if you want to recover everything, then you have an action. Now you have an action. You have now an action of GAF on X or on gamma under X. And you may look at the space of automorphic form. So now you can look at automorphic form. Automorphic forms. What do they are? So they are functions. On gamma mod X. And that satisfies similarly two conditions. Regularity conditions. I will explain in more details. And asymptotic behavior. The gross condition, the same. So it's simply a translation of the standard ones, the one you had, and there is a small grain of salt to see. So the regularity condition, again, it's a ZG finite, where G is the Lie algebra of G infinity, which is the same as G of F tensor R. Exactly similar. And you have a K finiteness. K finite, but now I have to say what is K. So now K will be K infinity times K finite, the finite part of K. So K infinity is the maximum compact or of finite index, doesn't make any difference. Maximum in G infinity is G of F tensor R. I already said that. And K finite, the K finite, sorry for the finiteness under K and the K index F as a finite basis. So KF is what? Is an open compact subgroup in G of AF. So the adelaide point outside infinity, so that's the finite part.
So this finiteness just corresponds to being smooth in terms of representations.
So, for example, at finite places, it says that it is invariant under some open compact subgroup,
which means
it locates constant. So it's extremely strong. And the vectors are smooth also at real places because they are ZG finite. In ZG, you have elliptic operators. Mm-hmm. And so this implies that the functions are analytic. Mm-hmm. This is the kernel of some elliptic operators. So they are analytic. And they transform under a finite dimensional representation of the K infinity. So you have all these regularity conditions. So when you look to the KF, so if you look at G of Q, say F equals Q to simplify, or doesn't matter, G of F intersection with KF, this is what's called gamma, the previous setting. The gamma is nothing but the intersection of the rational points with KF.
This gives you the possible gammas. So that's the translation between the classical language and this Adélie language. Condition is again to be formulated in terms of now you have to introduce a height, but it's really pretty much similar. It's just the kind of polynomial growth when you go to infinity. So to describe it, you have to, if you want really in general, to have the picture, you need to understand what is so-called what's the name? Oh, I'm sorry. I'm stupid. I should reduction theory. So-called reduction theory. So to describe somehow the fundamental domain. You have to know what it means and what. So you have to understand a little that, or you simply ask that the function don't grow faster than the polynomial in some quantities that are constructed out of the element of the group. So you have to define so-called eight functions. Or you go back to the classical picture, depends on what you prefer. So you define eight functions, and you ask that it is no more, the growth is not more, not worse than polynomial growth under for the eight functions. Okay, well, I'm far from the end of what I wanted to explain today. May I go on, or should I stop, or
maybe we'll go.
I can go on.
Well, maybe some short break and then.
No? What do you say? It depends on how this is.
How long have you...
What is it?
At least I would like to discuss cut form and the spectrum. Yeah. The discrete spectrum. A little.
Yeah, we make a short tea break and then... Right. Yeah, like for 15, 20 minutes, right?
If you want,
let's see. I may have things to do with the secretary also, so I don't know if she's still here or not.
No, there is no problem with this room.
No problem with this room. Huh? This room is free today.
No, probably the easiest thing is just I go on for 15 minutes and I stop there, because otherwise it's I will not be in good shape in any case. So just 15 minutes and I stop. Okay?
There you go.
Okay. So let me just explain very quickly what I have to come back on this thing when discussing the stress formula. So it's not too important to do it now. That the A0 was 0. So what does it mean? In fact, the A0 is obtained by integrating the function f of tau plus u du of r over z. Because remember,
function, and you have a function which is periodic of carrier 1. So it's just the integration like that. This gives you the answer. This is a constant, the constant Fourier coefficient. You in the classical language, modular forms is a function on the upper half plane or on the on both planes, but upper and lower, but with some invariance. And in particular, it's invariant by translation. So you take the Fourier expansion. If you take the Fourier expansion, the zero coefficient is this one. So the Q series is just a Fourier expansion.
So it doesn't depend on T, on tau. It's
a constant. It's a constant. Remember, F of tau is the sum of An Q to the N with Q is e to the 2 pi I tau. So for N equals 0, this is just a constant.
So the sort of orthogonality of character. This is the fact that the integral of a character is zero if you don't leave this computer. Well,
well, the holomorphic tells you that it's independent of time. Because of holomorphic. So, if you look at it as a function around the infinity, you have a function in a pointed disk, which is holomorphic, and you develop it in Lorentz series. Mm-hmm. And the gross condition tells you that there is no negative part, and you just have a constant term plus the other terms, and the constant term is the zero. And it's obtained, it's a result of holomorphic. So A0 is a constant here, but in general it won't be, so it's not. But you remember that the condition is A0 equals zero. So now what is R of Z? R of Z in that case is the translation by one U1. With U in R, but Z, because it's invariant by 1 and 0. So that's the way that gamma is that, gamma tau is tau plus U. Gamma is 1 U, 0, 1, gamma tau is tau plus U. So it's just the action of the unit of the nilpotent matrix. So you integrate on nilpotent matrix. Now, this such an object, so the group U, I call it usually N, and not U. 1, 0, 1, this is called a unipotent radical. Of a parabolic subgroup, in that case, which is a Borel subgroup, which is simply the set of matrices with a zero, so upper triangular matrices. So now, what is the general picture? For example, G equals GLN. What are the parabolic subgroups? Up to conjugacy, a typical parabolic subgroup is something with triangular right blocks. That's a typical picture. So up to conjugacy, a parabolic subgroup for GLN is something which is
upper triangular by Vlox. And on the diagonal, you have the so-called Levy subgroup. So P equals LN or MN, usually when you use N, for reasons that are not completely clear. And the N is just the guys that are here 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, and anything here. So that's the unipotent radical. The guys that are above the Levy with a 1 on the diagonal by blocks. Well, similarly, you have NA. NF, this is the analog of R mod V. This is a compact. This is always compact. And the Gauss form is something for which the integral over all unipotent radicals vanish. Of any parabolic. This is a finite number of conditions because up to conjugacy you can always conjugate the rational elements because the function is invariant under rationals, and since it has to be equal to zero for all x, this is invariant by conjugacy, and up to conjugacy you have a finite number of these guys. So as a function, so this is called the constant term if you prefer. This is called sometimes f index n of x, and you ask that the fn are zero for all n.
I would say maybe f of xn, right? Because of the epsilon.
No, you integrate. You integrate. Now it's invariant under the new Poisson group after integration.
I mean, do we consider we consider the epsilon of G of A on automorphic forms, and we restrict it to unipotent radical, right?
Yes.
Because in the sub direction is like through right translations.
Yeah, yeah, but it's not the action of the group. Here you just look at, you have a function.
No.
You destroy the, here you have destroyed the invariance under GF. You have destroyed it. Here, this is no more. This is no more GF invariant.
Ah.
F index N is invariant under M of F, but not under.
Ah, so it's about that. It's not the averaging.
It's an averaging, but as always, this is M of F left invariant. But no more, or P of F, if you prefer.
X small is from what?
X is anything in GF.
And it depends on X, yeah?
A priori, it depends on X, but I ask it to be the zero function.
But in the case of elliptic curves,
it didn't depend. It was a very special case.
Okay.
It was because of holomorphic.
Okay.
And you can consider a more general, not modular form, but form for GM2 and so on, where the constant term, so-called constant term, is not constant. We call this a constant term along N. But it's not a constant function. It's it really depends on x in general. It was very special to view a complete situation. Now, what to conclude, what I want to say is that the cusp forms are not only slowly increasing, they are rapidly decreasing at infinity. And in fact, in the function field case, they are even compactly supported on the quotient. So the point is that, and I will stop with this, so the point of all that, the cusp forms are rapidly decreasing in the classical case. You have an expansion in Q with a positive power of Q, so they are exponentially decay at infinity. The decay at infinity is exponential. So, in general, they are rapidly decreasing. In particular, they are square integrable.
That means only modulo A G. No?
They are square integrable on the tax mod gamma, which is mod AG. Or if you prefer, this is isomorphic to GAF1 mod GF. But I prefer this picture to the other.
And what did you say about the exponential growth? What is it? Exponential growth of here in this situation.
In this situation, I say, for example, that J.
J
as an angle is as an exponential growth, because it starts by 1 over Q.
Yes.
You remember G is 1 over Q plus 740 or something like that. Plus
and Q is exponential, yes.
Yeah, the Q exponential. So 1 over Q is as an exponential growth, because Q is e to the 2 pi I. Tau, and if you select tau of I plus IV, it's Q is essentially e to the minus 2 pi V. So 1 over Q is exponential of 2 pi V. So what? I think the absolute value is equal. So the Q are exponentially decaying, while 1 over Q is exponentially growing. So these guys, we never consider. And the cusp forms are rapidly decreasing. So to study, that will be the end of my lecture this morning, to study cusp form, it makes sense to consider the space ages of gamma and the S. So we will study this space, and the spectral decomposition is a study of this space, and the trace formula is a way to compute the action, the trace of some operators on this space. So I'm sorry, I am a bit out of schedule, but I have to stop. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. So as far as I understand, this is an analogy of the theorem of Harishchandra, right?
It's a generalization of Peterson inner product. The way Peterson has introduced an inner product for modular forms, this inner product is exactly, after translation, it's just the scalar product of X mod gamma form. When you translate, as I explained, how to translate classical modular form to function with some homogeneity, you just have to change the behavior and the aging. You have to change slightly. If you don't work with SL, if you want to work with GL, you have to change the behavior under AG, which is nothing, because it's just multiplying by an absolute value of to some power s, it's really nothing. It doesn't change here, the analysis previous. So up to that, or if you work with GA1, you even don't have to do that. Then it's exactly this the scalar form that you have in your textbook here. So that's the most possible generalization of Petersen minor form.
No, I mean not the Archimedean analysis, I mean non-Archimedean analysis. So last week we were studying that the discrete standard theorem saying that representation of a local non-Archimedean reductive group is cusped literally its metric squares have almost the post modulo sign.
Yeah.
I think this is
absolutely
this is the non-Archimedean part of the thing. So.
Absolutely. In some sense. You have that's something I wanted to explain, but I didn't have time. You have a kind of parallel permanently between the local and the global picture. And in fact, but one has to be slightly careful. Cusp forms are usually for function fields, they are compactly supported. While for a number fields, they are not compactly supported. They are just rapidly decreasing. But certainly not.
But on focus supported on the Archimedean.
No, doesn't mean anything. No. because an automorphic form is not a product of local objects. It's not a product of local objects. But you can extract from it objects that will be product of local objects. And then you can begin to think of what you said, but it's not direct. It's not direct. So you have to be careful. But still, the analogy is really there. Mm-hmm. It's really that. And again, for function fields, cross form are compactly supported. Modulo this part of the center. Just this part of the center is enough. Yes.
Derivative.
What is derivation?
Derivative.
GA1 is a kernel of the map to AG. GA1 is just a kernel for GLM. GA1 is just a kernel of the absolute value of the determinant.
GA1.
Yeah. It's a one. It's not a sure. It's not a derivative. It's still reductive. I mean, for example, for a unitary group, you don't have to bother with any such thing. So okay. Yes.
In J2K, we have a natural normalization condition. I mean that A1 is equal to unity. We have a normalization condition for Fourier coefficients. I mean, A1 is equal to unity in J2 case. Yes. But in general case, is there some analog of this normalization?
No. In general, we don't normalize the forms. There is no natural way to do that. In any case, in general, you are not interested in the special vectors, you are interested in the representation generated by vectors. So what will be canonical is the representation and not the vectors. The fact that you can choose a very nice vector, this is quite special to GL2 and to the even to the classical case. Otherwise it's up to scalar, it doesn't make sense. In general, I find so. Well, at least I don't know anything. No. What will be so? Another step would be to pass from forms, which are vectors in representation, to the representation. So I'm sorry.
Sorry.
Okay. So see you tomorrow, same time.
So there is something now.
Да, 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 да,